What's up, y'all? This is Revolutionary Fitness Radio, episode 30.
The revolution will not be televised. The revolution is here.
Welcome to another episode of Revolutionary Fitness Radio. I'm your host, Sean Garcia, and this is the podcast dedicated to bringing health, fitness, and wellness to the people. Our goal, empowering you all to understand your body, treat it well, and give you the tools to become an agent of change in your community through helping others. Let's move together.
The perseverance of a rebel, I drop heavier levels, is unseen or heard. A king with words, can't knock the hustle, but I've seen street dreams deferred. Dark spots in my mind where the scene occurred. Some say I'm too deep, I'm in too deep to sleep. Through me, Muhammad will forever speak. Greek brothers with handshakes on ghetto landscapes, where a man is determined by how much a man makes. Pop cognacs and spit
old raps. Today's guest is Fernando Reals, educator with the New York City Department of Education, working out of the South Bronx. In addition, he is also a brown belt in Brazilian Jiu Jitsu and teaches it to young people in the Bronx at his high school and out of Bronx Jiu Jitsu. We discuss his work with young people in the Bronx and the transformative qualities of teaching them Brazilian Jiu Jitsu. He also took a trip to Brazil recently, and we talk about some of the Jiu Jitsu social projects out there and how the model can be adopted here in the States. Hope you guys enjoy. This episode is brought to you by Manduka. Manduka provides the best yoga mats, yoga products, and yoga gear, all eco-conscious and high quality. Founded on the simple idea that a better yoga mat can make a world of difference, Manduka is the leader in yoga mats, towels, yoga props, and yoga mat carriers. RevFit loves Manduka products, and you can find out our favorites on our site by going to revolutionaryfitness.org/Manduka. That's M-A-N. D-U-K-A. All right, guys, so we're here with Fernando. Fernando, thanks for joining us this evening.
No doubt. Thank you.
So real quick, just talk about, you know, how you got into jiu-jitsu and martial arts in general.
Man, I mean, like just about anybody growing up in the 80s and 90s, I definitely grew up. I saw Karate Kid. I saw blood sport. I remember when there used to be kung fu movies on like the weekends and what you want to call it. I think that like just being a kid growing up in general, wondering about all these things and wanting to dabble in it, I always had an interest in martial arts, but my mom could never afford it. And like there weren't any free programs in my neighborhood that I knew of. There was a couple of kids who did karate in my neighborhood and stuff like that, but I had no access. So I kind of put that on the back burner. It was like a dream or a wish really, but I had no plan to get into it. So fast forward to like my young adulthood, I went to college. I graduated from college, came back to New York City, set on being a teacher. So I was working on my master's degree, blah, 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 trying to get a master's in education. And I think I started getting like some of that the refund money from loans and stuff like that. And I signed up for like karate classes somewhere. And I did that for a little while, and it was kind of cool because I was kind of like getting into it, but it was like definitely more of like what sometimes people refer to as a McDojo. Mm-hmm. It was like, you know, there was like over hundreds and hundreds served, but they didn't really know us and I didn't really know them. So after a couple of months of like trying karate, I kind of fell out of love with it. And I was still, like, you know, working on my graduate degree in education and piecemealing jobs and, you know, spending time in schools. And I was just kind of getting out of shape, getting into worse and worse shape. And I was, like, revisiting this idea yet again. I'm like, I need to get into martial arts because I've done a lot of work to my brain, but I haven't put enough into my body. And I need to get in, like, I needed to get in shape. I was, like, 250 pounds. It was affecting my asthma. And so I was sitting there at work one day. I remember I worked at CUNY, at LaGuardia Community College. I was helping people coming out of Rikers get into GED programs and into CUNY. And one day I'm sitting there in my office with a computer, and I start like looking up Bruce Lee and what he did and so on and so forth. And I found a school that in New York City was teaching Jeet Kune Do, like the philosophies and the fighting styles of Bruce Lee and his like primary student and best friend, Guru Daniel Santo. And I just checked out that school. I went over there. And like the motto was like, learn to fight in the street where it counts. It was really about like self-defense and defending yourself. And that was the start of it. I signed up. I started learning how to box, kickbox, fight with weapons. and grapple. And that was like my introduction to training martial arts and considering myself a martial artist as an adult.
So what was it, the physical fitness aspect that was attractive to you as an adult? Was that what it was? I mean, or did you get into it for some other reasons?
It's a mix.
The childhood affinity, yeah.
I mean, it's a mix. Definitely, I was always interested in the martial arts, you know, from seeing those movies as a kid. I think there's a lot of things there. I feel like as a young man, you know, as a boy, when I was watching those movies and then, you know, growing up and becoming a young man, you've always got these ideas about, like, being able to protect yourself and being able to protect others. So there's always these questions of, like, if it came down to it, how would I protect myself and protect others? You know, I had been lucky. I didn't really fight a lot as a kid. I didn't really have to. I outsmarted people left and right. I didn't get bullied too much. I had friends who would fight and knock a dude out for me if I needed it. And like, I didn't really have it much. I was pretty popular. I did my graffiti thing. We didn't have that much beef that ever came like that. So I didn't have to deal with it that closely growing up. I don't have much stories of, like, you know, fighting and getting beat up or anything or beating someone up. So it wasn't that, but like by my young adult stage, when I'm back in New York and I had gotten that big, part of it was like the health piece. I wanted to get in shape. I mean, I felt like literally like asthma. Like, I mean, going up the flight of stairs from the first floor to the second floor was taxing. Like, I think of my kids now, like, yo, miss it. That's too much work. And it was like pretty sad. I was like, you know, I can't get up the flight of stairs without like feeling a little bit of tightness in the chest. And that's a problem. But the other side, the flip side of it is, I was so big that everywhere I went, people were like, yo, big man. Hey, big guy. What's going on, big guy? Let me talk to you, big guy. So I remember, like, you know, going to Brooklyn to, like, some bar with a bunch of, you know, activists, folks that I was, like, cool with, comrades. You know, it was a mix of people, some queer folks, some women, different folks. And, like, the bouncers, you know, coming from, like, a place of patriarchy, like, addressed me when they were having a problem with our group. Mm. And, hey, big man, let me talk to you, big man. And it's crazy. I'm like, you know, there's a bunch of people here. You can talk to anybody. But he chose me because I was like the biggest person in the group, and I was a male. And so, like, you know, he had some words with me, and it was a little tense. It was definitely like a moment where, like, I thought, oh man, I'm about to get into a fight with a bouncer. And I was like, I don't know if I'm really prepared for that. Like, I don't know if I'm going to make it out of this fight too good. I think like incidents like that and just a mix of things got me thinking, I really do need to like focus on learning some self-defense. The other piece is I had been doing security, you know, which is a phrase I haven't even used in a long time, really. But I mean, the concept of if you're part of an organization doing grassroots community organizing or activism, and they're going to engage in activities on the street, whether they're permitted or unpermitted, you want to have an element of security or people who have a sense of safety and want to make sure that the membership that's engaged in the activity are safe. Whether that means being safe as a buffer, like between people and, who, you know, on the street and police, or whether that's a buffer between people who believe in one particular issue and like folks who might believe something differently and might want to attack those folks. I mean, I started volunteering and providing security services in many ways. And again, it wasn't about like trying to get into fights with people. It was about learning how to diffuse and de-escalate. But the reality was that there was always an element of a potential physicality. So here I am, I'm like, you know, helping out like the Malcolm X grassroots movement, or the Justice Committee, you know, with a demonstration, a rally, a protest, a march, or, you know, an immigrant rights organization, and I'm helping organize these events, and I'm there on the street trying to, like, help de-escalate and diffuse. But sometimes you're like, whoa, can I possibly defend myself or defend somebody else if stuff goes down? Mm-hmm. And I was like, well, I better learn how to. Mm-hmm. And that was another piece of why I started training in Jeet Kune Do and martial arts.
Right. So you got in, into the JKD stuff, and then you really started gravitating, obviously, to grappling and jiu-jitsu. You know, this is something that's become a little bit more popular in the U.S. in the recent decade or so, with the introduction of USC and things like that. So what was it about jiu-jitsu specifically that got you excited and passionate?
So cool. I mean, for one, I like to say the Jeet Kune Do, in many ways, and I started doing it like over a decade ago. In many ways, Jeet Kune Do was in the U.S. like the first manifestation of mixed martial arts. Mm-hmm. The idea that Bruce Lee had, like, Bruce Lee was a phenomenal martial artist. He practiced Wing Chun, he practiced Kung Fu, or like his name, Jun Feng Kung Fu, was a particular way or expression of doing Kung Fu that he did. And then, you know, he he had a situation where he didn't end the fight as quickly as he thought he could. He did not end the fight as efficiently as he thought he should. And then he started reevaluating martial arts and was like, well, we shouldn't use no one way as the only way. And our only limitation should be that there are no limitations. And so he started, you know, studying many different martial arts and trying to absorb what is useful in different martial arts. So I feel like the JKD school I went to, that, I mean, that was like MMA before the term MMA was popular. This is before the UFC was on Spike TV, before it was like Fox Free, you know, UFC fight nights. I mean, this is when UFC was the kind of thing that was traded amongst martial arts nerds on VHS tape.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, JKD is like a university, I felt like, and you could study so many different things if you're into JKD. And at some point, I felt like I started majoring in this thing called grappling. Realistically, doing like self-evaluation, boxing was good. I liked punching, but I hate being punched. Muay Thai, I felt like this is amazing expression of martial arts. It's perfect for the little guy or the little woman, because like it's like about speed and explosiveness. And being somebody who was like plus 230 pounds, I was an asthmatic. Speed, explosiveness, running around, punching, kicking, getting punched, getting kicked was not my thing. I mean, I had to learn it to a level of like proficiency to defend myself, but it wasn't like I loved it. It's like every single time I had to go do that, I dreaded it. And weapons was cool. I loved weapons. I definitely thought like learning how to defend myself against weapons and using weapons like a stick, very simple thing like a stick or two sticks and a knife, like coming from the Filipino martial arts, a Kali, a Eskrima, or a Nice. I loved that as well. But the one thing that I felt like I completely gelled with, and it fit my body type, it fit my physicality, my attributes, and my mentality, was with the Brazilian Jiu Jitsu. And what it is about Brazilian Jiu Jitsu that I liked was it was raw. It's like, you know, it's just you got two arms and two legs. That's what my instructor said. Everybody's got two arms and two legs. And you got to face somebody else who's got two arms and two legs, right? It's something that, you know, you practice and did without a weapon, right? I mean, we're talking about self-defense and we think about weapons and all these other things. But in terms of jiu-jitsu, it's about wrestling. It's as old as anything can be. Like, it's you're wrestling another human being. It's like the ultimate game of mercy. You're wrestling another human being, and you're imposing your will on them, and you're going to, like, make them tap. You're going to make them submit. You're going to make them say, okay, you got this. Game over. Let's start again, you know? And you can do it as hard as you want. You can really train pretty vigorously, very aggressively, but you can also do it really safely. So you could go hardcore and train, you know, as much as you want in jiu-jitsu and generally make it to work the next day without that many bumps or bruises. You might still get some. But compared to the boxing and the other stuff, it's a really amazing martial art. You can really train it hard and be okay. The other piece for me personally, I mean, again, like boxing, kickboxing, that whole kind of mentality, there's really very little, I mean, for me, the way I expressed it or I trained in it, there's little room for a pause or a break. For grappling, I felt like, you know, once I get the upper hand or whatever, once I can get my grips on you and control you, I can take a break, think about what I'm going to do next, and then keep moving from there. And so it allowed me to breathe and it allowed me to, like, express myself, and it was amazing. The other piece, upon further reflection, is my job was, you know, why outside of myself and outside of, like, defending myself, you know, if I wanted to, like, help people out as an activist, as somebody involved in community organizing, I had to, like, evaluate which martial art out of all of these martial arts was going to help me, which one of these martial arts was going to prepare me to do stuff and give me a skill set that could be used, like, on the street during a demonstration, a protest, or, let's say, at an event. Right. You know, if, like, an organization has a rally or an organization organized a concert. Which one of these? Well, I mean, I can't bludgeon somebody with a stick. I certainly shouldn't be stabbing somebody in a situation like that with a knife. Boxing somebody out might only serve to escalate the situation. But if I, like, grab somebody and subdue them and then control them and tell them, like, no, it's time for you to go, and these are some of the things you can do if you train jiu-jitsu, then we got something to work with here.
Mm.
So that and the fact that outside of, like, my political work, I mean, my work was in schools. Again, asking, like, that same set of questions. If there's a situation in the school, you know, I've worked in high schools. If there's a situation in the school, I can't hit a kid with a stick. I can't, you know, take out a weapon on a child. I should never be punching or kicking a kid. For jiu-jitsu, I mean, I've used it in schools. I've been able to, like, you know, stop a kid from fighting another kid by just holding them the right way, twisting his arm just a little bit, walking him over to the principal's office and saying, you need to cool out. Mm-hmm. Or there was a time where, like, I saw police arresting a kid on the street and his brother was going to run and get into an altercation with the police to try to save his brother. And I was able to, like, grab the kid, put him in a hole, wrap my legs around him, mm-hmm. take him to the floor and whisper to him, are you kidding me? Like, do you want your parents to pick up two people at the precinct tonight mm-hmm. or one? Let's think logically here. And so again, a way to express myself physically, it would do like less damage or just could be done strategically. I felt like that's something that jiu-jitsu gave me.
Right, right. So outside of the physical and that those very practical reasons, is there anything about the history or the origins or the spiritual essence of jiu-jitsu that you made a connection with? Maybe it wasn't initially, maybe it's now. Is there anything that you feel, you know, spiritually you have a connection with this art?
It's interesting because, I mean, jiu-jitsu is not, jiu-jitsu is from Brazil, but it's not capoeira. So one thing that a lot of people who don't know, like, you know, you say, yeah, I do jiu-jitsu, and then they'll make like those like stereotypical karate sounds or whatever. And that could be frustrating. It's also equally frustrating when you say, oh, I do jiu-jitsu. And they're like, oh, that's that beautiful stuff the African slaves used to do. I'm like, no, it's not. Like, I mean, the history of jiu-jitsu is not as romantic from a political standpoint as capoeira might be. Or maybe even our niece or Kali, mm-hmm. if you're really interested in studying like the history of like Filipino martial arts. Jiu-jitsu was, you know, simply a group of Japanese immigrants, colonists, people trying to set up like a community of Japanese immigrants and possibly like corporate types in the early 1900s. They were going to Brazil. They would go to Brazil. They would bring their martial art with them, which at that time was Kotokan Judo / Jiu-Jitsu. And, you know, through a series of, you know, exchanges and connections, they made a promise to teach their martial art to a particular family and a particular set of folks, and that's like the Gracie family. So a lot of times you hear about Gracie Jiu-Jitsu as being the origins of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. There were other people besides the Gracies that learned it, definitely people with less money. But the Gracies, you know, were a pretty moneyed family, a pretty elite family, and in the beginning, jiu-jitsu was really offered mostly to the elite and mostly to people who could afford it, which is actually similar to Bruce Lee. I mean, mm-hmm. he's wonderful, but he was teaching people who had tons of money, and it wasn't accessible to working class and poor folks for the most part. So fast forward a bunch of years, and after there was like, you know, decades upon decades of people studying jiu-jitsu in Brazil and it becoming more and more popular throughout Brazil, some of the people who were getting promoted to black belt and becoming professors in their own right began to teach these classes in many different settings. And now to this day, many of them have created social projects. So there are ways to access jiu-jitsu in different communities, like the you know, so-called favelas, the communities that have like lower, so, you know, lower income and areas that are kind of like cut off from like the mainstream infrastructure. There are projects in all of these kinds of communities around Rio where people could train in jiu-jitsu for free and so on and so forth. So there's been a shift in it, which is really beautiful and something that motivates me. Yeah. But on the real, I mean, I think that jiu-jitsu is quite literally the only thing I can think of, and I've thought about this a while, that somebody could become really like addicted to that doesn't have, where the positives outweigh the negatives. Mm. Like it's like a healthy addiction. I feel like I haven't met a person who's gotten into jiu-jitsu and really gotten into it and really felt the bug that it hasn't made their life better. Mm. And so if that's like, you know, not on like a religious tip, but like on a spiritual tip, I feel like jiu-jitsu becomes sacred. And the tatami is a sacred ground. I feel like it's where people connect. So jiu-jitsu brings people together and it changes lives. The rich and the poor, folks across different backgrounds, they're training on tatamis together, on the mats together. The weak go and try to learn jiu-jitsu, and they become more confident and they become stronger. The overweight join jiu-jitsu and they become healthier. They lose a little weight. You know, the shy person starts doing jiu-jitsu, and all of a sudden they're coming out of their shell, and they feel a lot more like confident. They become a little bit bold and audacious. the real cocky dude or the real cocky chick who thinks like they're the super athlete, they go into jiu-jitsu and they become a little more humble. And so in many ways, I feel like jiu-jitsu has these benefits that are incredible to like kind of just make, and it gives different things to different people, but I feel like jiu-jitsu literally has a way of like making anybody that it touches, anybody who's touched by jiu-jitsu, a little bit better than when they first started. Mm. And sometimes a lot better.
That's awesome.
As human beings.
So let's take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll talk about your little pilgrimage to Brazil that you just did and the work that you're doing up in the Bronx. We'll be right back.
Cool.
Smoking Joe Frazier, the Hellraiser, raising hell with the flavor. Terrorize the jam like troops in Pakistan. Swinging through your town like your neighborhood Spider-Man. So all tick-tock and keep ticking. Well, I get you flipping off the shit I'm kicking. The Lone Ranger, co-ed, danger. Deep in the dark with the art to rip the charts apart. The vandal, too hot to handle your battle. You're saying goodbye like Devin Campbell. Roughneck, Inspector Dex on the set. The rebel, I make more noise than heavy metal.
The way I make the crowd go wild. Sit back, relax, won't smile. Ray got it going on, pal. Call me the rap assassinator. Rhymes rugged and built like Schwarzenegger. And I'ma get mad deep like a threat. Blow up your project, then take all your assets. Cause I came to shake the frame in half with the thoughts that bomb shit like math. So if you wanna try to flip, yo, flip on the next man. Cause I grabbed the clip and hit you with 16 shots and more I got. Going to war with the melting pot.
It's the Method Man for short, Mr. Map. Move it on your left. And set it off, get it off, let it off like a gat. I wanna break food, cop me back. Small change, they putting shame in the game. I take game and blow the nigga out the frame. And like fame, my style will live forever. Niggas crossing over like they don't know no better. But I do, true, can I get a sue? Enough respect due to the 1-6, ooh, I mean, oh. Yo, check out the flow like the Hudson or PCP. When I'm dusting, niggas off because I'm hot like sauce. The smoke from the lyrical blood make me
what, grab my nut, get screwed. Ow! Here comes my Shaolin style. True, B-A-B-B-Y-U. To my crew with the...
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Come on, baby, baby, come on. Baby, come on, baby, baby, come on.
Yo, you best protect your neck.
First things first, man, you f*** with the worst. I'll be sticking pins in your head like a f*** nurse. I'll attack any nigga who's slack in his mat. Come fully packed with the fat brother stack. Shame on you when you step through. Two, the old dirty bastard, straight from the Brooklyn Zoo. And I'll be damned if I let any man come to my center. You enter the winter, straight up and down. That shit at cam, you can't slam. Don't let me get fool on the man. The old dirty bastard is dirty and stinking. Ace on unique rolling with the night of the creeps. Niggas be rolling with a stash. Ain't saying gas, bite my style. I bite your motherfucker.
My style is wild, so book me. Not long is how long that this rhyme took me. Ejecting styles from my lethal weapon. My pen that rocks from here to Oregon. Here's more again. Catch it like a psycho flashback. I love gats.
All right, guys. So we're back here with Fernando. And Fernando's just basically been breaking down his history with jiu-jitsu, his feelings towards jiu-jitsu, some of the liberating things that jiu-jitsu can do for a being. But now talk a little bit about the work that he's been doing over the past couple years, and recently you just took a trip out to Brazil with your family. Just want to know a little bit about what you saw in Brazil, and it's pretty interesting too because you went there at an interesting time politically. I mean, Brazil is always an interesting place politically, but you know, you went right after the World Cup was finishing up in Brazil, and there was a lot of stuff going on around that. So can you talk about your experience a little bit?
Yeah, so I mean, I've been training jiu-jitsu here in New York under Brazilians who had relocated to the U.S. For quite a number of years now, and I wanted to experience it firsthand. I wanted to get a sense of what the culture that is the cradle to jiu-jitsu was like. So I applied for a grant for a fellowship called the Fund for Teachers Fellowship, and I was able to access the fellowship. I was awarded this travel grant, and what it does is it allows for a teacher in the public school system in the U.S. to go travel and learn about something that will enrich their classroom. So backtrack a little bit. I mean, I've been working in schools for a long time, and I was able to pitch and convince, you know, principals in the past to let me do a jiu-jitsu club. And so I've been running a jiu-jitsu club in the South Bronx. For at this point, we're going into the fourth year of the club at this one high school I've been working at for a while. And it was an idea that one of the students had. They were like, hey, you do this cool stuff. Could you bring it in for us? And I was like, of course. So, you know, backwards to forwards. I mean, I've been doing the jiu-jitsu club for a while, teaching kids on a regular basis, a couple of times a week some jiu-jitsu. And here I am, like, with this opportunity in my hand, an application to try to, like, get some money to go to Brazil. Mm. I went for it. I got it, and it was an incredible trip. My proposal was to go down and to train at a couple of different academies in order to think about and learn about how people train in the cradle or the mecca of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I especially wanted to focus on getting access to or visiting a few social projects, which I didn't think would be, I thought it would be pretty difficult, and I didn't want to do it in like this whack kind of like U.S. Anthropologist kind of way. where I just show up like in some like random favela with my camera and everything. I'm like, hey, here I am, guys. Let me see what you do. So, I mean, I was like definitely conscious that this could be tough and dicey, and I wasn't really sure how it would work out, but it was like the most incredible trip ever. So I simply, you know, I mean, we pack our bags, my wife, my baby, we head down to Brazil. We could not go during the World Cup. It would have been lovely to be down there and to be a part of all of that energy, like the positive energy of people coming from around the world to celebrate a sport that's like the most popular sport in the world, which is, you know, football, soccer. That would have been great to also see like the intense kind of like, you know, response from the community in Brazil, mostly of working people saying like, wow, there's all this money being poured into like build kit and things that are not good for anything other than a sport. But the reality of the matter is Brazil is super expensive and ridiculously overpriced. And like even getting like a room in a hostel in the favela was like, I'm talking like $300 a night during US dollars during the World Cup. So we had to strategize and we ended up flying in 2 days after the final. So when we got there, it was over. But the cool part is that we did get to see a lot of folks who were from all across Latin America, maybe even some from Europe, who were just in town. So it was like definitely a vibe. Rio de Janeiro is where we flew into. It's an amazing city. It's one of the most beautiful cities I've ever been to. In many ways, it's a city. It's a real city. We're New Yorkers. And like, you know, we like New York's a real city. You got subways, you got buses, you got taxis. It doesn't sleep. Like there's always a place to eat or drink. And I mean, there's lots of cities in the world, but they're not all like this. And Rio is. In many ways, Rio has a nightlife. It's got a lot going on. It's got an amazing infrastructure. But in ways, it's nothing like New York because it is gorgeous. I mean, it is a beautiful city. It's got the most lovely beach, amazing mountains, amazing parks. It's a health conscious city. You got people, you know, all over the place, like thinking about joining gyms, in gyms. Working out on the street. There's like even like facilities for senior citizens, like at any park they could go work out. There's like all of this stuff just set up for them. So it's like this amazing kind of city that we get into. And I'm like, I'm walking around and like, part of me is like, is it going to be like a stereotype or am I dreaming? Am I going to see people in like in kimonos? Am I going to see t-shirts that say jiu-jitsu? Or is that all like hype? They're like, I'm coming with these Western eyes, like this gringo perspective. And I don't know, man, but truth be told, yeah, like you go to Brazil and people are into jiu-jitsu and people are working out and like you get on the train and there's dudes with messed up ears because, you know, they got the cauliflower ear because they've been training like their whole life. And I mean, like on any given day, like a whole day would not go by without you seeing some evidence of people who are actively involved in the sport and the life. So like here I was and like, honestly, I think we landed like on a Tuesday. By the time we got to the place we were staying at, like, you know, it was a Tuesday evening. My first mission was to get us a meal, and I don't speak Portuguese, so I'm walking down the block trying to get food. And to my left, I see a CrossFit gym. To my right, I see like one of those treadmill type of gyms with lots of cardio stuff. And then like around the corner from where I went to get food, there was a jiu-jitsu studio. So I'm like, that's in my first initial walk of 20 minutes, like in Rio. And after that, it was just, like, incredible. Like, there were, like, I don't know, like, 24 jiu-jitsu schools just, like, in the 30-minute radius around where I was staying.
Wow.
And it was just incredible and off the chain. So, nothing. I started from there. I joined a couple of schools and then took off from there.
Yeah, yeah. It sounds like the experience that people get when they go to India looking for yoga. They're, like, they walk in and there's, like, a yoga school every two blocks or whatever. It really is like the mecca. Why do you think there's such a focus on physical culture in Brazil?
Man, I don't know. I'm not sure if I was able to crack that code in the short time I was there. But I mean, like, if I were to venture to guess, the reality of the matter is, it's a beautiful place. We were there during this past summer. From New York perspective, it was summer, so it was, you know, we were in the south, so it was the winter. But winter meant it was about 70 degrees, 80 degrees. At least at the lowest temperature, it dropped to like maybe around 60 something, and everybody was like freezing cold. It was like such a mixed culture. So it was like, it was winter, but people were on the beach every day, like, and people are right by the beach, and there's a huge, a beautiful promenade that you could either ride your bike or longboard or rollerblades. I feel like there's just this connection to the outdoors. High school students, I mean, I've been working in high school for years. I mean, high school here is like, what, from 8 o'clock in the morning to 3 o'clock in the afternoon, 9 to 4, something like that. Over there, high school is like 5 hours long, tops. Mm. There's like 3 sessions throughout the day. You're either in the morning session, the afternoon session, or the evening session. So high school kids are all chilling most of the day. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like, adults, I don't know what the situation is at work. I really didn't, like, get to kick with a lot of folks, but it felt like, I'm sure there's lots of people are working. I'm also sure there's a lot of people out of work. But I sure can tell you there was a lot of people always either on the beach, at a Botica game, having like some beers and some food. And so it's like this culture where there's like a chilled out vibe. Like people work, they work kind of hard for the set amount of hours they have to work. They party kind of hard, and they also seem to work out kind of hard. The idea of training or working out is huge. Mm. Everybody tries to work out somehow, some way. Most people are walking around in workout gear. It's an incredibly different kind of space than New York City.
Wow. So what was your experience with the social projects that you were able to connect with, and what lessons did you get from them to bring back to the Bronx?
Awesome. One thing, like, number one, I thought that I was going to see something really, 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 really rare and unique and, like, super special and hidden. And, I mean, it was special, but it wasn't rare or super unique. The reality of the matter is that I think the people who've been training in jiu-jitsu for a long time, at least in Brazil, who have a sense of, like, forget about a sense of social justice. It's like a humanistic sense of, like, looking out for their neighbor. Many of them run a program of some sort. Mm. Many of them volunteer sometime, whether it's, like, teaching self-defense, teaching kids in a favela, teaching something to somebody, teaching blind kids, teaching kids with, like, different disabilities. There's a lot of stuff like that going on. So that was one thing that was really eye-opening and awesome. Just about any favela in the kind of like central Rio section had a program. So it wasn't like just one or two. Sometimes in a favela there was two or three different programs. Like different academies had different programs. So I saw a bunch of stuff. I was impressed and inspired because I saw little kids training jiu-jitsu. Now, it happens here in the U.S., but I don't get to see enough of it just because of my own work schedule. And so I've always been hesitant or kind of nervous about it. I've been working with high school students and teaching them. But the school I work at here in the Bronx also has a middle school component, and I've never thought about teaching them jiu-jitsu. I didn't think that they could handle it, that they had the maturity, and now I'm convinced otherwise. I feel like I saw really amazing programs with middle school age and even younger kids in Brazil learning jiu-jitsu. It's a little different. The really good professors had a lot of games involved, a lot of jumping around. It really, in some ways, some adult might argue, well, that's not jiu-jitsu. But skillfully, the professors were molding them to physically be more prepared for jiu-jitsu when the time was right, and to teach them about respect and discipline, self-discipline, how to work with a partner. So there's a lot there that I learned. And then the most incredible experience I had was at this particular social project that I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about. Called the Fernando Terere Kids Social Project. There's an amazing, super charismatic character named Fernando Terere. He's an amazingly gifted athlete. Rose to like stardom in the 90s, and he's a hero to most. And I just, you know, in the back of my mind, I'm like, I'm going to Brazil. I'm going to try to meet everybody, but it's going to be like, hey, how you doing? I'm, you know, Fernando. I'm from New York. I train with Vitor Shaolin. And I mean, I knew that would open doors because Vitor Shaolin's a legend, and I'm really lucky to have him as a professor. But I didn't think I would make connections like I did. When I went down there, just kind of like with the approach I had, and also being that I was a purple belt under Vitor Shaolin when I showed up, that definitely opened up doors. But no door was more amazingly open than the one at Perere's Academy. I met this guy, and he was like the most gregarious dude I've ever met. He is like wonderful, beautiful, all smiles, super like energetic, charismatic, welcomed me in. I walk in, and there's a room full of beasts, people who are like hardcore, been training hard, and like just scary as all hell, along with a couple of gringos and foreigners and, you know, people who are like coming from all over the world who are interested, and then a bunch of kids from the favela right above the school. And I'm like, what the heck is going on here? Because in every other experience, I kind of went to like a traditional school. I met somebody. They were amazing. And they're like, hey, I run a project outside of here in the favela. You want to go check it out? I'm like, yeah, sure, let's go. But in this situation, I go to the academy, and the academy itself is an academy, and it's a social project. So the way it works is this. Anybody who can afford to pay, pays. That includes people who live in Ipanema, Leblon, you know, Copacabana, these different neighborhoods of Rio de Janeiro. Those folks pay. Any foreigner who comes, like let's say you're from another part of Brazil and you're there for like a couple of days or a couple of weeks, you'll pay tuition. If you're from like Colombia, Chile, Argentina, you know, Puerto Rico, La República Dominicana, United States, the UK, you pay. But all of the kids, and I actually believe some of the adults, who live in the favela, if they can't afford to pay, they don't pay. And so, and then the thing is, it's not like separate classes. There's a kids class for the little kids, but in the evening when it's like the all ages class, you're just alongside, you know, the lawyer, the banker, the guy who's on vacation for a month from the UK, the person who relocated from the US for a year to like become an MMA star. You're all sharing the mat together with kids who are doing this day in and day out in order to do something better. Then, you know, whatever kind of knuckleheadery you can get involved in if you're just chilling in the favela and don't have something positive to do.
That's amazing.
It was amazing.
You know, what was it? If they weren't separating the classes and everybody was working out together, there wasn't obviously that stigma like, oh, you're getting the free class kind of thing and you're getting the paid class. So that obviously, you know, why isn't more schools doing that basically? Why is it an exception?
You know, I don't know. I'm not sure why other schools aren't trying the model, but what I can tell you is that I do know that why this school is doing it that way is because of the leadership of the person who pulled together. Mm. Fernando Perere was from the favela. He's from Cantagalo. He still lives in the favela. Mm. He could have become like a superstar and left and maybe opened up a school in another country and made like tons of money, but he just didn't feel right doing that. He felt like the model was to provide for, you know, provide a space for the best jiu-jitsu instruction, but to make sure that it happens for the people who need it most. Kids like who are growing up the way he grew up. Kids who could like possibly like let jiu-jitsu change their lives. But we talked about it. Like he was like, you know, not only is jiu-jitsu changing their lives, jiu-jitsu changing everybody who goes there. Because again, there's people who could be really, you know, I don't know, closed-minded and not really care about the other and like not really consider like the lives of other people. And all of a sudden, here you are like sharing blood, sweat, and tears together, and the tatami together, and you're like, okay, I got to have a lot of respect for this person right here. So it's an incredible, incredible model. I'd love to see more like it. I could see other people not being comfortable necessarily. You know, it might be too radical for some folks, but it seemed really like genuinely awesome down there, and it's actually something that's inspired some of the work we're doing here in the Bronx in many ways.
That's awesome. So let's go back and or forward, whatever. I don't know what order we're in now. But let's talk about the work that you've been doing in the Bronx at your school and also at Bronx Jiu Jitsu.
Cool. So basically, I've been working in public schools for over a decade now. And a lot of that time I've been on Rikers Island, actually working with students who were in jail awaiting like sentencing. And so at some point I switched out of the work on Rikers to work with kids in the Bronx where I live, because I felt like, you know, let me work with kids before they get to that stage. Let me try to help guide kids to avoid like that whole school to prison pipeline and look for like some alternatives. So at one school, there was a wrestling team, and I would teach jiu-jitsu to the wrestling kids like on their off season, and that was a lot of fun. But then I switched schools for whatever reason, and at this other school where I am, there was nothing like wrestling, there was nothing like jiu-jitsu, there was nothing other than the traditional, you know, PSAL, after-school sports, like, you know, basketball, softball, so on and so forth. And so, kids had heard that I did jiu-jitsu, that I knew some martial arts, you know, to them I was kind of scary or whatever, And I thought it'd be a really cool way to break the ice and connect the kids in a positive way that wasn't just about like reading, writing, arithmetic, or like, oh, you're in trouble because you came to school late. I wanted to like have a really healthy dynamic. So I started just teaching jujitsu after school. At first it was like with no uniform. So it was like no gi jujitsu. Just, I would tell kids show up in a pair, you know, a pair of shorts and a t-shirt. We had these like really rinky dink mats. We would fold and unfold. We'd put them in the cafeteria, which was pretty gross. And we started training there. And we did that the first year. And then luckily there was like a fundraising board. There was like, you know, kind of connected to the school, really cared a lot about raising funds to get us more programming. And somebody had this amazing idea to reach out to the UFC. And the UFC heard about my program. And then they kicked in $5,000 for us to get some professional, like, you know, wrestling mats and other equipment we could use.
Awesome.
So that was like the initial like big chunk investment that we got. And so when I got that, when we got that at the school, I got really motivated. I started talking to a lot of the people I've been training with about my program and said, really, I really want to be a hardcore straight up jujitsu program. And what I would need to make that happen is I would need uniforms. So then via social media, using Facebook, talking to folks, word of mouth, I just started putting out there, I'm teaching kids for free in the South Bronx. I want them to be able to have an opportunity I never got as a kid. And what they need is a uniform. So if any of you people who train jujitsu, and like jujitsu is like anything, like once you get into it, you start buying tons of stuff because that's what capitalist society just does to us, the consumerism, right? So a lot of guys, a lot of the folks I've done jujitsu with own way too many uniforms. And sometimes they feel like, oh, this one's old, I don't like it anymore. So I just started collecting all of these gis. So I've been collecting donations of gis for years now. Sometimes my wife's like, I'm going to put you out with all these geese. There's just way too many of them in the house. But yeah, I've been collecting geese. So now we're at a point where any kid shows up, says, I want to try jujitsu. I'm like, here's a uniform. If you like it, take it home and wash it. It's yours. You don't have to give any money for anything. And so that's, it's been going. It's been going strong for 3 years. I've got, I don't know, like at this point, there's about 16 to 20 kids on the mat on a regular basis, twice a week, at the high school itself in the after school program. Everybody's got a uniform, whether it's an old used one or maybe a brand new one from companies such as Ronin Brand, who hooks me up with uniforms at a cheap rate, which I get somebody else to pay for, or VHTS, very hard to submit, who's like this, they're an amazing small jiu-jitsu company, and they've given us free uniforms just because they believe in what we do. So we give them the uniforms, the kids train, and then those who are super dedicated and have been showing that they're really interested in it, I try to take them to the next level. You know, in some ways, I think of it as leadership. I give them an opportunity to train, not just in the tatamis at the school twice a week as the after-school program, but I invite them to start coming through to Sunday open mats at an academy, an actual dojo called Bronx Jiu Jitsu. Then my good friend Junior Ortega and his brother Nate opened up about, at this point, 2.5 years ago. So in the beginning with that, you know, like they were a small school and they were trying to figure out ways to pay the rent. So I had this idea of getting scholarships for a couple of kids to train there. So the kids were from my school. They would train a bunch of jiu-jitsu and I would just reach out to like some donors. Some really good people looked out and paid their tuition. And that was going on for a couple of summers. And now at this point, Bronx Jiu Jitsu is like this really wonderful, amazing outpost for real hardcore Brazilian Jiu Jitsu training here in the Bronx. And it's got, you know, it's got its own legs to stand on. And so they've made a decision to really support my program. No longer do we need a sponsor, a donor to pay the tuition. Any kid who really dedicates themselves on the tatamis in the after school program, they get sponsored and they train at Bronx Jiu Jitsu for free. So through that process, we've kind of like grown like a small like stable of like sponsored athletes of young folks who are like learning and training and spending a lot of time with like really wonderful adults and family members who all come together and train, and they're doing their thing. I mean, they're competing, they're winning medals under me or through my tutelage, or me and Junior's tutelage. We've got three kids who went from like nothing and have never paid a dime to train martial arts to become blue belts. So we've got three young men at this point, and there's a young lady who's well on her way to getting a blue belt in jiu-jitsu in about a week or so.
Does she know about that? Is that a surprise to her?
She's training hard for it.
I was like, is she going to get this episode and be like, oh, my God.
Oh, God, it's me. No, she's aware. She's like on the roster. The way it works is, you know, it's a relationship we have with our professor, our master, Vitor Shaolin Ribeiro. When we see that the student is putting in the time and the effort, they develop a certain level of skills, he invites them down to his academy in Manhattan. They do certain checkpoints. They learn some things. They show what they got. And then at some point, there's like a ceremony or graduation where, like, you know, they got to go in there and they got to go kick butt. And then at the end of the process, they get their belt. And it's a beautiful thing. So I'm talking about like three kids who got their blue belts at the same, like right as they were graduating high school. So it's dope. It was like, oh, I got a high school diploma and a blue belt. Like, wow, look at me. And then like, I got awesome. This, the young lady, she graduated. So she's already started college. And actually a young man who graduated and started college, he's actually getting his blue belt as well. So look at that. I think I got like five blue belts. I mean, they're under Shaolin, but you know, I'm the one that gave them their start. So it's really something I'm really proud of and I'm really happy about.
So, you know, what do you think? I mean, we've kind of talked about it a little bit already, but now that we're speaking specifically about the programming you guys are running out of the Bronx, what do you think jiu-jitsu does for these young folks? I mean, folks in general, but for these young folks specifically growing up in the South Bronx?
Oh, man, it's an interesting thing. Like, I feel like I've got a mix of kids involved in this. So, you know, I think that the jiu-jitsu program, the way we're running right now, or like coming from the school I'm in, I mean, I'm in a school in the South Bronx in a pretty impoverished and rough area, particularly. So the kids I have are all like really wonderful kids for the most part. Like none of them are really getting into too much trouble. So in some ways I'm like, oh, I wish I could like attract like kids who are really on the edge and really in danger of doing something really bad. I don't necessarily have like super roughneck kids coming through, and this is not like saving their lives from like, you know, a life, you know, like this kind of like scary romance thing of like a life of violence and drugs. You can say, okay, it's not like that. I'm getting kids who come into the Bronx, live with families who care a lot about them, who work too damn hard, who don't have enough access to like, you know, health resources, who don't have enough access to education around health stuff. So who don't exactly know how to get in shape, who don't exactly know how to eat right, who don't exactly know what it is you should or should not do in order to like have a really solid balance around like health and the responsibilities you have in the day. That's the reality. I got kids who are like, yo, I want to come in. I want to get in shape. I want to come through. I want to learn how to defend myself because honestly, I live in the Bronx and sometimes it's scary and I don't know how to fight. And that's a lot of the kids I get in my program. And I also get the kind of kids who are like, yo, actually, I do know how to fight and I need to figure out a way to deal with that because like, honestly, I'm mad and there's a lot going on in the world. And like, you know, if things go down a certain way, I might pop and I might knock somebody out. And if I don't come to this mat, then, you know, I feel really off kilter. And so the mat provides a space for them to like deal with some of those emotions in a really healthy way. I literally have a kid who I love very much, like a brother, who like comes through. And I feel like he comes through to get a beat down sometimes because he needs to like let go of some of that stuff. And he wants to put the beats on somebody, but he wants to do it in a way that's productive and like safe, where he's not going to hurt anybody and nobody's going to get hurt and nobody's going to get arrested at the end of the day. So it provides an outlet for all of these kids for different reasons. Some want to get in shape. Some want to like take care of like their own mental health, but they don't have like the words to say that. They just feel like they need a place where they're accepted and a place where they could be distracted from the drama of their lives. And some of them really do need a place to stay after school because, I mean, what is there for them? They're like, I don't know what to do after school. I'm not trying to get into trouble. It's a mix of things that this program provides. But then, like, the added piece is a community, a family. It's like, you know, we're there for each other. And they're seeing, like that's the thing about jiu-jitsu. So the kids who come to the academy, to Bronx Jiu-Jitsu, there's people from all walks of life there. There's people who feel really successful right now. There's people who are struggling to make ends meet. There's like single folks. There's full-on families. And they're seeing all these different models. And folks are different. And they come in for different reasons. But jiu-jitsu brings them together. And so these kids are seeing that. And they feel a connection to that. And that's been really wonderful.
That's awesome. So you've been doing jiu-jitsu now, I mean, I guess for the better half of your adult life. And you just recently got promoted to a brown belt. And recently, we're talking about like yesterday.
Yes, sir.
So congratulations on that big achievement. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
You know, yeah, and it's funny because one of my friends saw a post I put about you and they're like, oh, you're posting about your boy. And I'm, you know, because, well, obviously we've known each other for a long time. So, you know, we have a close relationship. But also just because of the work that I know that you do and what you will take this skill set, you know, and contribute to your community, a brown belt is not just a brown belt for Fernando and a great achievement for him, but a great achievement for, you know, all the kids that you're affecting and the people that you're touching throughout the Bronx and underdeveloped communities that you're serving. So the brown belt is a celebration of all that work. So, you know, congratulations on that. But my final question, I guess, is, you know, what do you want from jiu-jitsu?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, what do I want from jiu-jitsu? I mean, I've gotten so much from jiu-jitsu. In some ways, I have had every bit of those kids' stories in me. I'm the kid who has had like anger stuff and wanted to figure out a way to deal with it. I'm the kid who's been scared to walk down a certain like neighborhood because like what can happen here? Sometimes I'm afraid of what could happen to me. Sometimes I'm afraid of what I could do to somebody because I'm afraid of what could happen to my family. I'm the person who's like struggling to make ends meet. I'm the person who feels really successful compared to some folks that I grew up with. So there's all of that. I mean, jiu-jitsu is giving me a way to think about being in better shape, being healthier, being more sane, being more spiritually grounded and connected to others and believing in others. Jiu-jitsu's already blessed me in so many ways. It's given me a lot of gifts. But I think I what I wanted to do for me is to continue to give me opportunities to give to people. I don't want to say give back, but I don't know about back or forward, but to give, to keep giving folks around me something positive. So, I mean, I am very excited. Thank you so much. Like you contextualizing it like that gives me some food for thought. That's right. I'm a brown belt, and I'm a brown belt who's Latino in New York City in the Bronx and serving the Bronx. And wow, I guess that's pretty dope. I mean, Junior was the first brown belt in the Bronx that I know Latino doing this kind of work. And now there's me. And there's others. There's other folks who are coming up. There's an amazing purple belt named Bruce from another academy who's been training and teaching in the South Bronx doing very similar work. I want to give a big shout out to Bruce. But the reality of the matter is that, I mean, jiu-jitsu just gives us so much, and we just want to provide that to others. So it's, I guess, paying it forward. At some point, I'd like to be a black belt, and I'd like to be an instructor, like a full professor and a black belt teaching a ton of folks. And, I mean, maybe at some point, some money will come from it in order to like make ends meet and make sure there's a space for it. But that's not the driving force at all. It's really about giving people an opportunity to change their lives and to do really positive things in their lives and to have like really happy and healthy lives.
Awesome, man. Well, thank you for, you know, the interview, of course. Thank you for all the service that you've been doing to the community. You know, it's usually when we talk about thanking people for service, we're talking about it in the wrong context. You know, we're not talking about how it's really serving our people. So, you know, thank you for all that. And of course, you know, RevFit has mad love for you and Bronx Jiu Jitsu. So we'll definitely get all the links for people to get in contact with you in the show notes, because I'm sure a lot of people are listening and they're like, I want to do jiu-jitsu. So nice. We'll get them connected to you. And cool. Of course, we'll keep building in the future.
Cool. Thank you, Russ.
Thank you so much. Talk to you later, brother.
Thank you so much, Sean. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
All right. Peace.
Peace, bro.
Thanks again to Fernando for that awesome interview. Definitely doing a lot of great work out of the Bronx and doing a lot of great work in the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu movement here in New York City. If you guys want to find out more about Bronx Jiu-Jitsu and the work that Fernando is doing, you can definitely check it out in the show notes. Also in the show notes, we put the links to the different products that he was talking about who have helped sponsored his programming over at his high school. And also we have some links to some of the social projects that Fernando was discussing throughout the interview that actually are happening in Brazil, and that, you know, it's the model that they basically are trying to implement up here in the Bronx. So definitely, you know, go check out all those links, support all those products, support those social projects, spread the word about the work that Fernando and others are doing with the use of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and, you know, other forms of martial arts being utilized in underdeveloped communities. And of course, check in on our website, revolutionaryfitness.org, to find more out about us and about the work that we're doing. And of course, tune in next Thursday for our next episode of Revolutionary Fitness Radio. Hope you guys have a great week. Peace.
Yeah, one more time. 70 shit. Got the lean. Shit is leaning. It's to the left. Yeah.
It's just leaning, dribbling, like he gave me a bag of Doogie or a bag of that Tango and cash. It's just leaning and shit, 70s.
Lord Tariq.
Yeah. Yo, hey yo, I've been through many places, done many things, seen the eyes and many faces, from New York to Texas, to the faces on Rolexes, not a racist or sexist, and the best is the Lord, nonetheless is guns, nothing less than a Lexus, bubble eye with BBS's, troubled minds and troubled times, stacks, I'm trying to double mine, I'm in a six with double dimes and a couple of nines, me and tracks back to back, circle a block a couple of times, and we searching for this nigga to try, I'm bubbling mine, if we don't get him now, then we will in due time, I bust enough shots to kill him two times, I do crimes, I get caught, then my minds defined in my son's rhymes, cause my thoughts stay running like thugs from one time. I've been through it under the influence, busting off, I'm running into it. See me say he didn't do it, put the nine to his mind and blew it. Cause sometimes I lose it, give me a gun and I'll abuse it. Fucking with my family, my bitch, my money, or my music. Making killers say he's too sick when he do shit, but I'm on some new shit. It's too late, the fuse lit. I treat my nine like a new bitch, and the shit do kick.
I'm on the Bronx, Bronx with Fat Joe and my man. On the east side of town with a blunt in my hand. Soundview, Monroe, Castle Hill, Bronx Tale, Rosedale, Academy, Lafayette, Cozy. I'm on the Cross Bronx with Fat Joe and my man. On the east side of town with a blunt in my hand. Commonwealth, Theriot, White Plains, Brand New, Olmsted, Boynton, Colgate, Watson.
Play rap loud, politic and business with the crack crowd. Fat foul, funny how I never seen a rat smile. My last trial's one of the reasons why I rap now. But still could plow any nigga acting a rash now. Fucking with me's worse than ducking police. After puffing some trees, I'll probably be a duck in your knees. Murdering beats since the days of permanent crease. Been around the blocks and grants, converting the keys. Cartagena breaks hearts in Argentina. My mistress loves to love me, my wife act like Anita. Tell a squad to die for the cause, even if it means blowing up things and taking over City Hall. My shit is raw, straight from the Panama shores. If the feds can't catch me, then they make up a law. Can't take it no more, niggas is fake to the core. My state pen friends, I'll leave you broken negative more. Bet it all on the terror squad click for Forrest. Real Bronx niggas that's heartless and spark shit regardless. Niggas sitting to try that shit, that's why motherfuckers gotta die like this.
I'm on the Cross Bronx with guns, my man. On the south side of town with a brick in my hand. Forrest, Melrose, McKinley, the Boulevard, Washington, Patterson, Portland. I'm on the Cross Bronx with guns, my man. On the south side of town with a brick in my hand. Brookhaven, Cypress, Hunts Point, St. John, Littleville, Trinity, Creston.
Yeah. I had a dream that a team had a scheme, keeping the beam on my head like an infrared. He's dead, but I redeemed. Now I'm back, nigga. It's on, nigga. Run, nigga. Joe, nigga. Pun, nigga. Lord, nigga. Guns, motherfuckers ain't really knowing. I'm really going and feeling. I'm showing that my main objective is Benz is Lexuses. Got Rolexuses. Get bigger than Texases. So fierce, bitches, they be calling me exorcist. Far from a devil, I'm God. I mean, I'm guns and I shine like sun. Rhyme like none. Find my gun. Got beef with this nigga with hits and shit. Chips and shit. Run around here switching shit. Telling people don't play that, you gotta play this. Tell his crew you ain't saying that, you gotta say this. You can't wear that, you gotta wear this. Well, hear this, I go in your chest and leave you airless, fearless. The only thing between us if you stop my cream is a Glock 19. And I'ma pop like steam, trying to stop me and mom from eating. You need a doctor with 100 gauze pads, nigga, to stop you from leaking. And a prayer from the deacon as you weaken. And words from the funk, master flex dog, shouldn't have been reaching. There's only one gun from what it's worth, that's me, that's it. Burying your shit right in the earth. I'm on the Cross Bronx with Big Pun and my man. On the west side of town with the gun in my hand. With 74, Vice Ave, Riot, Longfellow, whole ass, Tona Park, Boston Road, Prospect. I'm on the Cross Bronx with Big Pun and my man. On the west side of town with the gun in my hand. Lambert, Tremont, Concourse, Jerome Ave, Third Ave, Ogden, Webster, Simpson.
Yo, we the Bronx Avengers, partners in these pylon adventures. We the monster niggas in your dreams. I be stomping your sense to soapy conscientious. If you march against us, I'ma call me Henders. And you know the script is gonna have to face the consequences. We large percentage and you small change. The niggas long range, strong gauge, leaving niggas drawn blades. Crime pays if you nice with yours. The Bronx is where you fight for yours. Ice across, slice of cigars all day. Wildin', freestyling in the hallway. Broadway ain't got more drama than watching off a Colgate. This ain't the old days. Shorties is busting, ain't no fucking joking. Some nigga call me a German, I had a bus, I'm open. My brother's holding me down with heavy artillery. Chevys and Willies be chilling in front of every facility. Joey's from Trinity, so he raps for us. You can save the best for us, but you still better place your bets on the Bronx, baby. Where the best get blown, my rest in zone. Come on, nigga, test your throne. I'm blessed with chrome, so leave your vest at home. I don't aim for the chest, bitch, strictly necks and domes. I'm on the Cross Bronx, 403 in my mans. Running up in your spot with the Mac in my hand. Pure energy, checkmate, blue thunder, obsession, pulp fiction, purple rain.